Red Brick Media. High quality CDs, DVDs, lectures, khutbah, conferences and Quran recitations. All revenue generated supports our dawah work, supported by visiting our store. You can now purchase directly from our site, www.redbrickmedia.co.uk.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيد خلق الله أجمعين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على سبيله ونهجه إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، before Ramadan, as you're aware, we covered the chapter of fasting, and then we said that inshallah post Ramadan we're going to do a slightly different schedule in terms of the classes of Bulugh al-Maram, and we're going to try to make it a bit more intensive and then space it out more as well. And so inshallah we won't be missing as many lectures as we were before Ramadan. So inshallah the plan is that in the month of September, from today until the end of September, we cover inshallah the whole of the chapter of Hajj, and then we'll break for Hajj and Eid, and then inshallah after Hajj and the Hajj period we'll begin with the chapter of prayer, which we missed out previously. So inshallah, we're going to begin with the chapter of Hajj, Kitab al-Hajj. Al-Hajj linguistically means the intention, to intend something. This is its linguistic meaning. And in the Sharia, its technical meaning is to intend to go and visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Mecca to do certain actions in a certain period of time. This is the meaning of Hajj. So you must go to the house of Allah in Mecca. You can't perform Hajj here in Birmingham or in Medina or in Syria or anywhere else. And you must go to do certain actions like the tawaf and the sa'i. There are certain actions that must take place in the Hajj, and it must be at a certain time. Meaning you can't perform Hajj whenever you want during the year. You can't go in the month of Ramadan for Hajj. You can't go in Muharram. There is a certain period of time that you go for Hajj. Okay, the months of Hajj, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, Allah says, Al-Hajju ashhurum ma'lumat. Hajj is in the well-known months. And these months are three: the month of Shawwal, the month of Dhul-Qa'dah, and the month of Dhul-Hijjah. 3 months. So after the end of Ramadan, from the beginning of Shawwal until the end of Dhul-Hijjah, the last 3 months of the year, these are the months of Hajj. Okay, that is the general timing of Hajj. So for example, if a person wanted to perform tamattu Hajj, meaning they want to make Umrah and then they want to make Hajj, and they want to make the Umrah as part of their Hajj, that Umrah for the Hajj must be within these 3 months. It must be either in Shawwal or Dhul-Qa'dah or the beginning part of Dhul-Hijjah before the days of Hajj commence. So a person, for example, can't just go in Ramadan and make Umrah and then go for Hajj and make that tamattu. No. It must be in the time of Hajj. Al-Hajju ashhurum ma'lumat. That is the general timing of Hajj. And Hajj also has a specific time. And that specific time are the actual days of Hajj, from the 8th of Dhul-Hijjah until the 13th of Dhul-Hijjah. These 6 days are the specific timings of Hajj. So the vast majority of the actions of Hajj are performed within these 6 days, from the 8th until the 13th of Dhul-Hijjah. So these are the two timings of Hajj. And the actions of Hajj must be performed within these timings. And then there are certain actions that you need to perform as well in order for the Hajj to be correct. And inshallah, we will go on to that in a bit more detail bi-idhnillahi ta'ala when the time comes and the place comes. So the first chapter that Ibn Hajar rahimahullah mentions here, he says, بَابُ فَضْلِهِ وَبَيَانُ مَنْ فُرِضَ عَلَيْهِ. The chapter of the virtues of Hajj and who it is obligatory upon. Hadith number 592. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال العمرة إلى العمرة كفارة لما بينهما والحج المبرور ليس له جزاء إلا الجنة. On the authority of Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, performing one Umrah, between one Umrah and the next Umrah, it is an expiation for everything between them, and the accepted Hajj, there is no reward for it except Jannah. And this is collected by Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim. It is muttafaqun alayh. So Ibn Hajar rahimahullah begins with one of the many ahadith that speak about the virtues of Hajj and Umrah. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, making many types of umrah and many types of hajj, it is something which will expiate all of the sins in between. So if a person performs umrah, then they go and perform umrah again, all of the sins between those two umrahs are expiated. And if a person performs hajj and then they perform hajj again, then inshallah, all of the sins in between those two hajjis are also expiated. والحج المبرور ليس له جزاء إلا الجنة. And if a person has an accepted hajj, what is an accepted hajj? An accepted hajj is where a person with sincerity performs all of the actions of hajj and all of the rites as they should perform them, while staying away from anything which will diminish that reward, any type of sinning or any type of lewd or evil acts, they stay away and refrain from that. If a person does this with the right sincerity and following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, then inshallah they will have an accepted hajj. And its reward is nothing less than Jannah. In a similar hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever performs hajj and within that hajj they don't do any evil act, nor any act that is lewd, then they return as if it was the day that their mother gave birth to them, meaning that they are sinless. It is an expiation for all sins. So this is something which is one of the virtues of hajj. In a different hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, perform hajj and perform umrah over and over again, for indeed they expel your sins and they expel poverty. So one of the reasons or one of the means by which you increase your rizq and you get more provision from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that a person continues to perform hajj and umrah. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, whosoever has the ability and the means to visit the house of Allah once every 5 years, then it is a right of Allah that they should do so. So if you have the means and the ability, the financial and the physical means and ability, to go and perform either umrah or hajj once every 5 years, then you should do so. This is a right that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has upon us. And it is one of the ways that we come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only performed one hajj during his lifetime. Only one hajj. And that is known as Hajjatul Wada' in the 9th year of the Hijrah. It's the only time he ever performed hajj. And he performed 4 umrahs during his life. 4 umrah during his life. However, he never performed umrah more than once a year. Just so happened that all of his umrah were at least 1 year apart. However, the scholars have said that it is better if a person is able to perform umrah more than once a year. So maybe perhaps you go in Ramadan, then you go for hajj, then again you go after hajj 3-4 times, or if you live in Saudi Arabia, you go a lot. This is something which is better, and it is something which is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, based on this hadith of Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu. The next hadith, 593, وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت قلت يا رسول الله على النساء جهاد قال نعم عليهن جهاد لا قتال فيه الحج والعمرة رواه أحمد وابن ماجة واللفظ له وإسناده صحيح وأصله في الصحيح. On the authority of Aisha رضي الله عنها, who said that I said, O Messenger of Allah, is there a jihad upon the women? And he said, yes, there is a jihad in which there is no fighting, al-hajj and al-umrah. And this is collected by Imam Ahmad and Ibn Majah, and the wordings of Ibn Majah, and it is an authentic hadith, and it is also mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari with a slightly different wording. This hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, where she asks the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam about the type of jihad that is obligatory upon the women, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam equates jihad to hajj. He equates jihad to hajj, and we'll also speak about this in another hadith that is coming up shortly as well. And that's because hajj is something which is unique from the acts of worship and the pillars of Islam in terms of it needing both wealth and it needing both physical ability. So for example, if a person has to pray, they just pray. You don't need to be rich to pray. You can be very poor and still pray. You don't need money to be able to pray. When the month of Ramadan comes and you have to fast, you don't need money, you don't have to pay to fast, you just fast. And if a person wants to perform zakah, then they need money, not necessarily physical ability. So if a person, for example, they're old and they're frail, or they're very ill, or they're suffering from some type of illness or disease, and they can't walk and they can't talk, yet they have enough money, and zakah is obligatory upon them, is due upon them, they must still pay zakah. because they have the financial ability. So the pillars of Islam, when it comes to the acts of worship, prayer, fasting, zakah, and hajj, are split into two categories. One is physical. So that's like prayer and fasting. It is purely physical. And the second one is financial. And that is zakah. Hajj is unique in the sense that it combines between the two. So just as jihad requires both, it requires finances and it requires physical ability. You can't do it without one, you can't do it unless you have both. Likewise, Hajj requires both physical ability and it requires wealth as well. And this is something, inshallah, we will come onto a little bit more in detail later. But this is the reason why Aisha radiallahu anha and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam equate Hajj and Jihad together. But the point of this hadith and why Ibn Hajar rahimahullah brings it here is because of the answer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that yes, there is a type of jihad that is obligatory upon women, and that is a jihad in which there is no fighting, no killing, and that is Hajj and Umrah. Because Hajj and Umrah requires a lot of physical exertion, requires a lot of effort, requires a lot of time, a lot of money. And so it is similar to jihad, but there is no fighting, no killing in it. Al-Hajj wal-Umrah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in this hadith, he mentions both. He's saying that yes, there is an obligation upon women to perform both of them, Al-Hajj and Al-Umrah. He doesn't just say it's Hajj. And this is an issue then which comes as an issue of difference of opinion amongst the scholars of Islam, alayhim rahmatullah. And that is, what is the ruling of Umrah? Everyone knows that Hajj is obligatory, and it's something which all of the Muslims agree upon. Ijma'ah. Hajj is obligatory. It's a pillar of Islam. If you're able to do Hajj, you must perform Hajj. But what about Umrah? Umrah is a form of lesser pilgrimage. Is Umrah also obligatory at least once in a lifetime like Hajj? Or is it just a sunnah? Is it highly recommended? Is it something which a person should do, but it's not an obligation? This is an issue of difference of opinion. And the reason why there's difference of opinion is because of the way that the term Hajj is used. So for example, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was saying that Islam is based on five pillars, Bunya al-Islam ala khams, he mentions the five pillars of Islam, and the fifth one he says, wal hajj. Right? Hajj liman istata'a ilayhi sabila, for those who are able to do so. So he doesn't mention Umrah, he says Hajj. And there are many ahadith like this as well. Yet in this hadith and other hadith similar to this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is implying that both are obligatory. He mentions Al-Hajj and Al-Umrah. And that's why the scholars differed over this issue. Some of the scholars said that Umrah is obligatory. Just as Hajj is obligatory once in a lifetime, likewise Umrah, if you're able to do it and you have the financial and the physical capability, then it is also obligatory once in a lifetime. And the second opinion is that it is not obligatory, it is a sunnah mu'akkada, a highly recommended sunnah, but if you don't do it, then you're not sinful. And the stronger of the two proofs seems to be, or the stronger of the two opinions seems to be, that it is obligatory. Umrah is wajib, just as Hajj is wajib. And the reason why in some ahadith or many hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam doesn't differentiate between the two is because Hajj is a term that encompasses both. Hajj is the major pilgrimage and Umrah is a lesser pilgrimage. Like when we say, for example, that prayer is obligatory. We don't have to say Fajr is obligatory, Dhuhr is obligatory, Asr is obligatory, Maghrib is obligatory, Isha is obligatory. It's understood when we say Salah is wajib, that all five, not just one, all five are obligatory. Likewise with Hajj. When Hajj is obligatory, it is the form of a greater pilgrimage. So the lesser pilgrimage comes underneath this as well. And this is taken from this hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, as well as the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in which he made a distinction between the two. The next hadith وعن جابر رضي الله عنه, hadith number 594, قال أتى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أعرابي فقال يا رسول الله أخبرني عن الأمرة أواجبة هي فقال لا وأن تعتمر خير لك رواه أحمد والترمذي والراجح وقفه وخرجه ابن عدي من وجه آخر ضعيف وعن جابر رضي الله عنه مرفوعا الحج والعمرة فريضتان. The hadith of Jabir ibn Abdullah رضي الله عنه, who said that a Bedouin came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and said, O Messenger of Allah, inform me about Umrah, is it an obligation? So he said, no, but to do so is better for you. And this is collected in Ahmad and Tirmidhi, and it is not a hadith but a statement of Jabir radiallahu anhu, and it is also mentioned by Ibn Adi with a weak chain of narration. And then Ibn Hajr rahimahullah mentions, and it is also reported from the same companion Jabir radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that Hajj and Umrah, both of them are an obligation. Both of these statements, both of these ahadith are weak. Both of these ahadith with these chains of narration, whether it is the first statement of Jabir radiallahu anhu or the second statement of Jabir radiallahu anhu, both of them are weak. Both of them are weak in the chain of narration. So it doesn't contradict what we just mentioned from the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, that both are obligatory, the Hajj and the Umrah. The next hadith, hadith number 595, وعن أنس رضي الله عنه قال قيل يا رسول الله ما السبيل قال الزاد والراحلة رواه الدار قطني وصححه الحاكم والراجح إرساله وخرجه الترمذي من حديث ابن عمر أيضا وفي إسناده ضعف. And the authority of Anas radiallahu anhu said that it was said, O Messenger of Allah, what is the path that Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in the verse in the Quran? He replied, it is that you have transport and that you have provision. Collected by Ad-Darqutni, authenticated by Al-Hakim, also collected by Al-Tirmidhi from the hadith of Ibn Umar, and it has a weak chain of narration. This hadith has many chains of narration, but all of them are weak. And Shaykh al-Albani says that all of them are weak, even though it has many different chains of narration. However, even though the hadith is weak, the reason why Ibn Hajar rahimahullah brings it here is to show the conditions for Hajj and Umrah. When does it become an obligation? Who is it obligatory upon? There are a number of conditions and criteria that must be met. Number one is obviously that the person must be a Muslim. Number two is that they must be mature, meaning that they've reached the age of puberty. And this is something, inshallah, which Ibn Hajar will allude to shortly in another hadith. Number three is that they have their faculty, meaning that they're sane. So Hajj is not obligatory upon someone who is crazy, or someone, for example, who is in a coma, who doesn't understand what's going on. Number four, Hajj is also obligatory upon a person who is free. So they must be free. So if a person is in bondage or in slavery, Hajj is no longer an obligation. These four criteria must be met. So Hajj is not obligatory upon children. It's not obligatory upon the insane. It's not obligatory upon the slave. And it's not obligatory upon the non-Muslim. In addition to this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, He says, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. And it is an obligation of Allah for those who are able to do so that they make Hajj of the house. So what is this ability that Allah is referring to in this ayah? This is what the hadith is referring to. And even though it is weak, this is what is meant in the hadith. What is this ability? So in addition to the four conditions that are mentioned, what is the ability that a person must have in order to perform Hajj or Umrah? And what The hadith mentions, and again it is a weak hadith, but the meaning is correct. And that is that a person must have financial and physical ability. Financial ability and physical ability. Financial ability means that you have enough wealth and enough money to go from your house, wherever you may live, to go all the way to Mecca, to perform the Hajj and stay there until the Hajj finishes, and then return home. And at the same time, you have enough money to look after your dependents and those people that you leave behind. So for example, if a person has enough money to go for Hajj, but they leave their wife and children behind with no money, they're penniless. And they're like, I'm going for Hajj for a month and you guys just do whatever you need to do, I'll be back in a month. That's not ability. They must have enough for themselves and enough for their dependents. Okay? And so all of that must be met. That is financial ability. And the second type of ability is physical ability, meaning that they can physically go to Hajj, perform the Hajj rites in Mecca, and then come back. So for example, in the olden days, that meant that you had to be able to walk, maybe. Or for example, ride a camel or a horse, depending on how you would get there. And then also have the ability to perform tawaf and sa'i and the stoning, and all of the different rites of Hajj. It also means that the path that you're going to take, the road or the path or the travel route that you're going to take, is one of security and peace. So for example, in the olden days, they would go by road, okay, or they would go over land, and they would pass through desert. But if by passing through a certain area, there were, for example, bandits or pirates, or there was a war going on, then now there's no safety or security. So therefore, now you don't have the physical ability. The Sharia doesn't obligate upon you that you go and put yourself in danger for the sake of Hajj. So now it's lifted upon you. That responsibility is lifted off of you. So for example, if a person has an illness, they have a disease, they're weak, they're old, they're frail, and they take medical advice, and the doctor says, don't go, it's too difficult for you, it's going to make your situation worse. Now Hajj is no longer obligatory upon them. And that again is something which inshallah will be mentioned in a hadith shortly as well. If for example a person doesn't have enough money, or they have enough money for the Hajj but not enough for their dependents, then again that obligation is lifted off of them. Hajj is no longer obligatory upon them until when? Until both of those conditions are met. They have the physical and the financial ability. And once they have both, then Hajj is obligatory. And once Hajj becomes obligatory, it is obligatory immediately. So a common mistake that is made is that people have the ability financially and physically to perform Hajj, but they delay it for a year, for 5, for 10, for 20, or people think after I retire I'll go for Hajj, when I'm in my 50s or 60s then I'll go for Hajj. And this is a very big mistake. Hajj is obligatory immediately. And some of the scholars said that the Prophet ﷺ, Hajj became obligatory on the 8th year of the Hijrah, shortly after the conquest of Mecca. Hajj became an obligation. But the Prophet ﷺ didn't perform Hajj in the 8th year. He performed Hajj in the 9th year, the following year. So he delayed it by 1 year. And in the 8th year, when Hajj became obligatory, instead he sent Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and he told him to lead the Muslims in Hajj. So some of the scholars said, why did he delay it then? If we said that it's obligatory immediately, why did the Prophet ﷺ delay it? And the reason for this and the answer to this is because during that time when Hajj first became an obligation, the pagan Arabs had a lot of pagan rituals associated with Hajj. So the Hajj stems from the time of Ibrahim ﷺ and Ismail ﷺ. It stems from that time. And the Arabs had taken some of that and they had brought it in to their culture, but they had also mixed it with their pagan rituals. So for example, they would make tawaf, just as we make tawaf, 7 times around the Kaaba. But they would make tawaf naked, for example. And that's because the Quraysh, the people who used to look after the Kaaba, the pagan Arabs, the Quraysh, they were of the mentality that you can't perform Umrah unless you buy your clothes from Quraysh, from the people of Mecca. So if you come from Medina, you come from Taif, you come from anywhere outside of Mecca, your clothes are impure. They're not of the right purity that you should then go to the Kaaba and make tawaf. So you must buy our clothes. So the people, the vast majority of them were poor. They weren't rich. They would have one pair of clothes for the whole year. And they would wash that same pair of clothes. They didn't have, alhamdulillah, like we have, like, you know, whole wardrobes full of clothes. And so they didn't have enough money. So they would say, we don't have enough money. So instead of saying to them, okay, go and perform Hajj or Umrah or whatever you want to perform in your own clothes, they would say, in that case, perform it naked. Go into your original state. Likewise, they would have tawaf and sa'i, sa'i between Safa and Marwa. But what they did was place 2 idols, Naif and Naila. Naila and Isaf. 2 idols, one on Safa and one on Marwa, and they would make sa'i between these 2 points, between the 2 idols. So they had sa'i, but it was also mixed with their pagan rituals. Likewise, the Arabs, the Quraysh in particular, they themselves would tell all of the pilgrims to go to Arafah, but they wouldn't go to Arafah. And the reason is because Arafah is outside of the Haram boundary. And so they would say that this Arafah, standing on the plain of Arafah, is for those people who aren't from Quraysh, aren't from Mecca. As for us, we are the custodians of the Kaaba. And so we don't need to leave the Haram boundary. So the point is that they had all of these rituals mixed up. Now had the Prophet ﷺ performed Hajj in the 8th year when it first became obligatory, then there would have been people, because they didn't know any better, the rulings of Hajj had not been set out, there would have been people making Hajj with him naked, others making Hajj between those sa'i between those two idols, others not going to Arafah. And the Prophet ﷺ would be making Hajj, but because of all of this confusion as well, people wouldn't know. Is this part of Islam? Is it not? And it would become confusing. Because we know that when the Prophet ﷺ made Hajj, there were over 100,000 companions. 100,000. And so for that 100,000, when something newly becomes legislated, there would have been a lot of confusion. So what the Prophet ﷺ did instead was he sent Abu Bakr. And then shortly after him, he sent Ali radiallahu an with a list of rulings that Abu Bakr was to announce to the pilgrims that you can't make Hajj naked. Go and cut down those idols on Safa and Marwa. Everyone has to go to Arafah and so on and so forth. And so it was known during that Hajj what the rulings of Hajj were. So the following year when the Prophet ﷺ made his farewell Hajj, the issue was already resolved. There was no confusion. Things were clear. And that's why we have, as we will come on to later inshallah, we have the full description of the Hajj of the Prophet ﷺ as he performed it step by step. The next hadith, 596, وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لقي ركبا بالروحاء فقال من القوم؟ قالوا المسلمين. فقالوا من أنت؟ فقال رسول الله. فرفعت إليه صبية وقالت ألي هذا حج؟ قال نعم ولك أجر. رواه مسلم. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم met a group of people in an area called Ar-Rawha. And this is like about 73 kilometers from Medina, an area called Ar-Rawha. So he said to them, who are you people? And they replied, we are Muslims. And then they said, who are you? And he replied, I am the messenger of Allah. So a woman from amongst them, she lifted up a small child. And she said, O messenger of Allah, does this child perform Hajj? And the Prophet ﷺ said, yes, and you will get the reward. And this is collected in Sahih Muslim. This hadith kind of follows on from the previous hadith when we said that one of the conditions of Hajj is that a person must reach the age of maturity or puberty. That it's not obligatory upon children. In this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ met a group of people in this area, approximately 70 to 80 kilometers outside of Medina. And it shows that not everyone was aware of the Prophet ﷺ, even though they were Muslims, because Islam had spread so much by that time. In the 8th, 9th, 10th year of the Hijrah, there were over 100,000 Muslims just on the Hajj. So there must have been many more that didn't come. And it's not conceivable that all of them knew personally the Prophet ﷺ by face, so they met him and so on. And so some of them didn't know who he was. So they said, who are you? The Prophet ﷺ asked them, who are you? And they said, we are Muslims. And then they asked him, who are you? And he said, I am the messenger of Allah. The point of this hadith is that then a woman, she lifted up a small child, a sabi. And a sabi in the Arabic language is like up to 5, 6, 7 years old. A small child. And she said, O Messenger of Allah, does this child perform Hajj? And the Prophet ﷺ said, yes, and you will get the reward. Meaning that yes, if you want to put the child through the rituals of Hajj, you can do so. So for example, you make the child wear the ihram. You make them do the tawaf. Whether you carry them or whether they walk or however you do it, they do the tawaf. And they do the sa'i. And they observe all of the restrictions of ihram and they do all of the different rituals. And you are there with them, obviously, during the stage and during all of these stages. If they do so, then you will get the reward. However, this hadith shows that because the mother or the parent gets the reward, that this Hajj doesn't lift off the obligation of Hajj. So when that child becomes mature, they reach the age of puberty, they must perform their obligatory Hajj again. And that's the one that they will get the reward for. So the first one is because the parent makes the intention, the parent is the one who puts the ihram on them, the parent is the one who makes sure that they do all of the rituals, the parent will get the reward, the mother or the father, whoever it is. However, once the child reaches the age of puberty, then they must go and make their own Hajj again, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The next hadith, hadith number 597, وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال كان الفضل بن عباس رضي الله عنهما رديف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فجاءت امرأة من خثعم فجعل الفضل ينظر إليها وتنظر إليه وجعل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصرف وجه الفضل إلى الشق الآخر، فقالت يا رسول الله إن فريضة الله على عباده في الحج أدركت أبي شيخا كبيرا لا يثبت على الراحلة، أفحج عنه؟ قال نعم، وذلك في حجة الوداع، متفق عليه، واللفظ للبخاري. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, who said that Al-Fadl ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma was riding behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and a woman came from the tribe of Khath'an, and so Fadl began to look at her and she began to look at him, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would turn the face of Al-Fadl away from her. So she said, O Messenger of Allah, indeed the obligation that Allah placed upon his servants of Hajj, it came and my father was an old man, he's unable to ride. So shall I perform Hajj on his behalf? He said yes, and that was in the farewell Hajj. Muttafaqun alayh, collected by Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim, and the wording is of Imam al-Bukhari. This hadith is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, narrates from his brother Al-Fadl ibn Abbas. Al-Fadl ibn Abbas was the older brother of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhum ajma'in, also the first cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And because Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma was young during the Hajj of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, parts of this journey and the rituals of Hajj he relates from his older brother Al-Fadl. And that's because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we'll come on to this later, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would send Abdullah ibn Abbas with the women, meaning that because he was young of age, he would send him with the women. But Al-Fadl was older, and so he would stay with the Prophet ﷺ, and so Abdullah ibn Abbas would take some of what happened in his absence and he would narrate it from his brother. So his brother was riding behind the Prophet ﷺ on his camel. And the Prophet ﷺ on his journeys, on his Hajj, he would make some of the companions ride behind him. And this was obviously an honor for those companions to ride behind the Prophet ﷺ. And Al-Fadl ibn Abbas was a very handsome young man, very handsome. And so this woman, a young woman, she came from the tribe of Khath'an to speak to the Prophet ﷺ and ask him a question. And so he began to look at her and she began to look at him. And so the Prophet ﷺ would turn his face away, so that obviously he doesn't look at her. And then he would look again, and again he would turn his face the other direction. And in this hadith, obviously we see that it is not allowed for a person, for a man, to look at a woman that is non-mahram for them, that they should lower their gaze. And that is why the Prophet ﷺ turns his face away. Yet we also take from this hadith the beautiful character of the Prophet ﷺ and the etiquette with which he turned his face away. He didn't say anything to him, didn't say anything to the woman, didn't shout at them, didn't rebuke them. All he did was turn his face away. And when he would turn it back, he would turn his face away again. And this is from the beautiful character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The point of this hadith though is the conversation between the woman and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that she says that my father, when the obligation of Hajj came, he was a very old man and he was unable to ride, meaning he doesn't have the physical ability to go and perform Hajj. So can I perform Hajj on his behalf? And the Prophet ﷺ said yes. There are a number of issues in this hadith that we need to bear in mind. This hadith speaks about the issue of what is known as Hajjul Badr, doing Hajj on behalf of someone else. In order, and there is another hadith that speaks about this as well, in order to do Hajj on behalf of someone else, number one, you must perform your own Hajj first. So you perform your own Hajj first, your obligatory Hajj, then you can perform Hajj on behalf of someone else. Whether that person is related to you or not, whether they're a parent or whether they've, whoever they are, you can perform Hajj on their behalf. Number two, that person that you perform Hajj on their behalf must be unable to do so themselves. So if a person has the financial ability, the physical ability, and they just want to sit at home and they say, you go and do my Hajj, that's not allowed. However, if for example, like in this hadith, that person is old or they're weak, or maybe they've passed away, or something similar to this, then now it is allowed. And this is what is known as Hajjul Badal, performing Hajj on behalf of someone else. Number three, the third point from this hadith, is that it's seen that it's allowed for each gender to perform the Hajj on behalf of the other. A woman can perform Hajj on behalf of a man can perform Hajj on behalf of a woman. And so the Prophet ﷺ here is saying to the woman, you can perform Hajj on behalf of your father. So it's not only males for males or females for females. Number four, the fourth and final point, is that they don't have to, that person that's performing Hajj on behalf of someone else doesn't have to be from that country or from that town. They can perform Hajj from wherever they are. So for example, maybe that person that passed away used to live in Pakistan, but the person that's going to perform Hajj on their behalf lives in Mecca. Now they don't have to go all the way to Pakistan and then travel from there to make the Hajj, no. They make Hajj from wherever they are. And that's why this woman, she didn't know the ruling, but she came to the Prophet ﷺ during the Hajj. This is in Hajj. They're in Mecca. And now she asks, O Messenger of Allah, can I perform the Hajj of my father? And he says, yes. And he doesn't say to her, go back to your tribe, then come back again with that intention. No. You are allowed to perform Hajj on their behalf, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Hadith number 598, وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن امرأة من جهينة جاءت إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت إن أمي نذرت أن تحج ولم تحج حتى ماتت أفحج عنها؟ قال نعم حجي عنها. أرأيت لو كان على أمك دين أكنت قاضيته؟ أقض الله فالله أحق بالوفاء. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, that a woman from the tribe of Juhayna came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and said, indeed my mother took a vow to perform Hajj, but then she passed away before she could fulfill her vow. Shall I perform Hajj on her behalf? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, yes, do so. Do you see that if your woman was in debt, would you not pay that debt off for her? Then pay the debt of Allah, for indeed that has more right that it should be fulfilled. And this is also collected by Imam al-Bukhari. This is a similar hadith, another hadith, and that is a different type of obligation of Hajj. Hajj is obligatory once in a lifetime, and that is the obligation that Allah has placed upon every Muslim who is able to do so. However, Hajj can also become obligatory in another way, and that is the Hajj of another, when a person takes a vow using and invoking Allah's name that they will perform Hajj. What is another? What is a vow? A vow is when you vow, when you take an oath by Allah, you use Allah's name or one of His attributes or one of His names, and you use that to invoke upon yourself and obligate upon yourself an act of worship. So for example, a person says, I promise Allah, or I vow by Allah, or I take an oath by Allah that I will perform Hajj, or that I will pray Tahajjud tonight, or that I will fast 2 weeks, or something similar to this type of statement. Now it becomes obligatory upon that person to do so. It is obligatory, not because Allah made it obligatory, but because they made it obligatory. Now generally when it comes to vows, the ruling in Islam is that it is disliked. The Prophet ﷺ said, don't take a vow, for indeed it brings no good and it only extracts from the miserly. Meaning that in order to worship Allah, you have to take a vow before you do so. So it's like you have to force yourself. You promise Allah and now then you're going to worship Allah. And it also is a type of arrogance, meaning that it's like you're doing Allah a favor. You take a promise that you'll do something for the sake of Allah. And so the Prophet ﷺ disliked it and he told people not to do it, for it only extracts from the stingy and the miserly. However, if a person was to do it, it becomes an obligation. Person then must fulfill that vow. So in this hadith, the woman, her mother took a vow that she would perform Hajj and then she passed away before she could do so. So now that obligation remains. Can that also be fulfilled by someone else? The Prophet ﷺ said yes. Do you not see that if she had a debt that you would have paid that debt off on her behalf? Then likewise this is a debt that is owed to Allah, and Allah has more right that his debts should be fulfilled. And so this is a different type of obligation of Hajj. Hadith number 599, وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أيما صبي حج ثم بلغ الحنث فعليه أن يحج حجة أخرى وأيما عبد حج ثم أعتق فعليه أن يحج حجة أخرى. رواه ابن أبي شيبة والبيهقي ورجاله ثقات إلا أنه اختلف في رفعه والمحفوظ أنه موقوف. This is a statement of Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما. The narration saying that it is from the Prophet ﷺ is weak. So it is authentic as a statement of Ibn Abbas that whichever child performs Hajj and then they reach the obligatory age of puberty, then they must perform Hajj again. and whichever slave performs Hajj and then they are freed, they must perform Hajj again. So this is something which we mentioned already, that Hajj is not obligatory upon a child nor a slave. So if they do so, it doesn't lift off that obligation. For the child, once they reach the age of puberty, they must perform Hajj again. For the slave, if they are ever freed, then they must perform Hajj again. It doesn't lift off the obligation in either case. Hadith number 600, وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يخطب يقول لا يخلون رجل بامرأة إلا ومعها ذو محرم ولا تسافر المرأة إلا مع ذي محرم فقام رجل فقال يا رسول الله إن امرأتي خرجت حاجة وإني اكتتبت في غزوة كذا وكذا فقال انطلق فحج مع امرأتك متفق عليه واللفظ لمسلم. On the authority of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, who said that I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam give a sermon and say that it is not allowed for a man to be secluded with a woman unless she has with her a mahram, and it is not permissible for a woman to travel except with the mahram. So a man stood and he said, O Messenger of Allah, my wife has gone for Hajj and I was supposed to go and participate in such and such a battle. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, go and make Hajj with your wife. Muttafaqun alayhi, collected by Bukhari and Muslim, and the wording is of Imam Muslim. This is another condition of Hajj, but specifically for the woman, and that is the issue of a mahram. The mahram is not a condition for the Hajj, it is a condition for traveling to the Hajj. It is not a condition for the Hajj, it is a condition for the journey. So for example, if a woman was to live in Mecca, she doesn't need a mahram to perform Hajj. She can just go and perform Hajj herself in Mecca. Okay, because she lives there, she doesn't need to travel. However, if she's more than a traveling distance, what's a traveling distance? The distance where you shorten and combine your prayers. If she lives beyond this distance, then she needs a mahram in order to travel. This is the opinion of some of the scholars of Islam, and others said that she can travel as long as there is peace and safety and security. And they use as evidence for this that during the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would make Hajj, and they would do so without a mahram. But rather Umar radiallahu anhu would send Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu to be their chaperone, if you like. He was the one who would accompany them, and they would travel within their khawkha, which is like a type of a room that they place on a camel, like a type of cabin, which they would ride in. And they would do so without any mahram, and Allah knows best. And so some of the scholars said that if you have that ability to travel in safety and security and there is no harm and no threat, then it is allowed. Otherwise, a mahram is needed. Whichever the case is and whichever the stronger opinion is, no doubt to travel with the mahram is closer to the sunnah and it is a safer opinion, and Allah knows best. But this is another condition of the Hajj for a woman, not per se for the Hajj itself, but it's mentioned here is because most women will travel to perform Hajj and they won't be from the residents of Mecca, and Allah knows best. Hadith number 601, وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سمع رجلا يقول لبيك عن شبرمة قال من شبرمة قال أخ لي أو قريب لي فقال حججت عن نفسك قال لا قال حج عن نفسك ثم حج عن شبرمة رواه أبو داود وابن ماجة وصححه ابن حبان والراجع عند أحمد وقفه. On the authority of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam heard a man say, oh Allah, I performed this Hajj on behalf of Shubruma. He said, who is Shubruma? He said, he is my brother or my relative. So the Prophet ﷺ asked him, have you performed Hajj for yourself? He said, no. He said, perform Hajj for yourself and then perform Hajj for Shubruma, collected by Abu Dawood and Ibn Majah and authenticated by Ibn Hibban. This is something which we previously mentioned, that if a person wants to make Hajj al-Badl, Hajj on behalf of someone else, they must first perform their own Hajj. And that's why when the Prophet ﷺ heard this man make his intention on behalf of someone else, he asked him, have you performed your own Hajj? And when he said no, he said, perform your own Hajj first, then perform Hajj for your cousin or your brother named Shubruma. And that's something which we also mentioned previously as well. The final hadith in this chapter, وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال خطبنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال إن الله كتب عليكم الحج فقام الأقرع بن حابس فقال أفي كل عام يا رسول الله قال لو قلتها لوجبت الحج مرة فما زاد فهو تطوع. رواه الخمسة غير الترمذي وصله في مسلم من حديث أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه. On the authority of Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, who said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was giving a sermon in which he said, indeed Allah has made obligatory upon you Hajj. So one of the companions by the name of Al-Aqra ibn Habis, he stood up and he said, O Messenger of Allah, is there an obligation every single year? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, had I said yes, it would become so. Al-Hajj is only once, and whatever is more than this, it is voluntary. And this is collected by the five except the Tirmidhi, and it is also mentioned in Sahih Muslim, but from the hadith of Abu Huraira. This hadith is mentioned in Sahih Muslim, as the author mentions in the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu an, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, O people, indeed Allah has performed Hajj upon you, so make Hajj. So a man stood up and he said, O Messenger of Allah, is that every single year? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam remained silent, and again he repeated the question, every year. And again the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam remained silent, and a third time he repeated the question. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, had I said yes, then it would become obligatory and you would be unable to do so. So leave me so long as I leave you alone. For indeed those who came before you were destroyed because of their many questions and because of their differing with their prophets. If I order you to do something, then do as much of it as you are able. And if I prevent you from something, then leave it alone. This hadith has a number of benefits. The primary benefit obviously is that Hajj is only obligatory once a lifetime. It is only obligatory once a lifetime. But from the other benefits of this hadith is that the etiquette of seeking knowledge. And that is that a person, they should only ask those questions that are relevant to them. And those questions that don't, for example, cause confusion amongst others as well. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is saying to this man, that if I were to say yes as a result of your question, then it would become obligatory every single year. And you wouldn't be able to do so. And we all know that if Hajj was obligatory every single year, we wouldn't be able to do so. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is saying, leave me alone so long as I leave you alone. Meaning, don't ask me questions that I don't place upon you. And that's why the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam were forbidden. Those who were close to him were forbidden from asking many questions. And Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَسْأَلُوا عَنْ أَشْيَاءَ إِن تُبْدَ لَكُمْ تَسُؤْكُمْ. O you who believe, don't ask about those things which if they become clear to you, will harm you. Meaning don't ask so many questions like the other nations did with their prophets when they would ask question after question after question. And because of those questions, Allah would make things more and more difficult upon them. So when Allah says it's obligatory, you don't have to ask, is it in this way and that shape and this fashion, but you just leave it. And that's why the companions radiallahu anhum would be happy when the Bedouins would come and speak to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because they would ask a lot of questions and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam wouldn't say anything to them. Why? Because they're visitors. They would come today and they'll be gone tomorrow. Whereas those people who are regularly with him, they were prevented from asking questions. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in another hadith, from the worst of crimes that a person can perform, from the worst of crimes in the sight of Allah that a person can perform, is that something becomes haram as a result of their question. So during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if someone, something was halal, but because of their persistent questioning, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam made it haram, that is a grave sin. Because Allah makes things easy in the Sharia. And so we make things difficult upon ourselves. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is establishing this important principle. But as we said, the main benefit from this hadith is that Hajj is obligatory only once a year. Okay, inshallah, there won't be a class tomorrow because of the conference. But inshallah, from next week, every Wednesday and Thursday after Maghrib, there will be a class. And inshallah, we will aim to finish the chapter of Hajj by the end of the month, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. So if there's any questions, inshallah, we'll take them, otherwise we'll conclude.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim.